Welcome to Mrs. True Crime. Today's video is an in-depth look into the murders of Clarence and Geneva Roberts. It's a tale of conspiracy and greed. If you're triggered by anything dealing with death, feel free to click off this video. Perhaps check out the squirrel video for some lighthearted content. If not, I'm Nicole. Let's get started. The story of Geneva Roberts is short and vague. The youngest of seven, born to James and Laura White in 1921, Nashville, Indiana, she didn't come from much. Not that it mattered. Geneva was kind and devoted, which may have been what attracted World War II vet Clarence Roberts to her. The two married in 1941 and together raised four children, Bernard, Forrest, Lauren, and an unknown fourth. For close to 22 years, Clarence worked with his brother Carson in a co-owned hardware shop in Nashville, Indiana. Clarence was incredibly well-liked and respected in the community. He won Brown County Sheriff in 1950, served as director of the Nashville State Bank, and obtained the 33rd degree status at the Masonic Lodge, acquiring a ring he rarely took off. But Clarence wanted more, and he strived to get it and maintain it. Finishing his stint as sheriff, and his brother Warren taking the reins, Clarence thought it was the proper time to get the things he felt entitled to. It started with a large home, bringing his family into an upper middle class tier. Then he added three luxury cars. The problem with his expenses was that the capital from the hardware store wasn't enough to maintain his lifestyle, so he sold the shop and opened Robert's Brother Lumber Company with his brother Carson. Together, they obtained several grain elevators and an apartment complex, stretching their properties to Akron, Claypool, and Mentone. Yet, these investments were miscalculated and only plunged Clarence deeper into the hole. Still hoping for success, Clarence obtained a loan from Wabash Life Insurance Company in 1967 or 68, but this only worsened his finances. Wabash alleged that Clarence submitted altered and fictitious bills totaling between $131,000 and $200,000. During the summer of 1969, lawsuits were filed against him. Farmer State Bank of Mentone won $45,000. Irwin Union Bank and Trust Company of Columbus was owed $9,000+. First State Bank of Morgantown defaulted a $25,000 mortgage on Clarence's home, and he also owed an undisclosed amount of money to the Nashville State Bank. He also had $900 to $12,000 in unpaid bills for six lumber companies and wholesale suppliers. To add insult to injury, in October the following year, his brother Warren repossessed two of his cars. But 1970 was an eventful year for Clarence. In June, Clarence was overheard discussing suicide after he rejected the possibility to file for bankruptcy. In mid-September, he spoke with his friend of 40 years, Alvin Haggard, owner of Al's Friendly Tavern, about his financial woes. Haggard claims Clarence never mentioned suicide to him, only that he wanted to get out of his debt. He showed Haggard a Swiss bank account card that Clarence claimed had over $100,000. Less than 2 months later, on November 3rd, Clarence spoke to another attorney about his suicidal thoughts, tearfully saying, quote, "My widow will be the richest one in Brown County," unquote. While the thoughts of Clarence's warnings and threats swirled around people's minds, no one took the man serious. He was Clarence Roberts, a hard-working Army veteran. If anyone could pull himself out of his own rubble, it was him. But that optimism soon changed. In the early afternoon of November 18, 1970, a bank officer knocked on Clarence's door, but received no answer. The officer wanted to discuss the allegations of a forged signature on a banknote. It's unknown how long the officer waited, or if he waited at all, but when Clarence Roberts didn't open the door, the officer left. Sometime later, Charles Roberts found his cousin Clarence mulching leaves. The two exchanged conversation. Clarence reportedly wore a solid blue shirt and mentioned that Geneva and Lauren were in Columbus for dinner. Not wanting to dine alone, Clarence invited Charles inside for a sandwich, but Charles declined. It would be the last time Charles Roberts saw his cousin. 15 minutes after their brief conversation, Ella Cummings, Clarence's neighbor, saw leaves burning at the base of a tree located near Clarence's barn. The barn on the Roberts property was 15 to 20 feet, with a small addition built onto it used as a storage unit and garage. The fire at the time was small, so small in fact that Cummings remarked that she probably could have stopped the fire herself. Instead, she called the fire department, who arrived 15 minutes later at 6:30 p.m. By that time, the fire had grown and engulfed the barn. Charles Roberts returned to the property around 6:45, but the barn had already collapsed. Though two of Charles's cars were repossessed, witnesses remarked there were several vehicles to the east of the barn and one inside. They managed to save the one inside, Charles's pickup truck. With limited water supply and the barn completely destroyed, firefighters worked on saving surrounding structures. Eventually, the fire dies, leaving firefighters spraying remaining ashes and walking through the wreckage to eliminate any other sparks and assist the damage. In the small addition, the 16-gauge shotgun resting on their chest was a charred body without their arms or legs. Found in the ashes of what remained of the barn was Charles' Masonic ring and a tooth. The body was taken to the morgue. Described as, quote, mystery man, 60 to 65 years old, balding white hair, and about 5'8", unquote. An autopsy was performed and carbon monoxide poisoning was ruled as the cause of death, but pathologists believe he died prior to the fire. Eventually, the mystery was theoretically solved. The deceased was Clarence Roberts, and he was buried as such at the local cemetery. However, there were too many perplexing questions to end the case abruptly. Evidence was taken and re-examined, one of which was Clarence's saved pickup truck. In December, the bank repossessed it and discovered a massive leak of fumes into the cab of the truck. There were over 30 hammered holes in the exhaust system. Could this play into the pathologist's theory that Clarence died prior to the fire? Carbon monoxide, according to the National Fire Protection Association, is an odorless, colorless gas created when fuel is burned incompletely. Quote, vehicles or generators running in an attached garage can also produce dangerous levels of carbon monoxide, unquote. Iowa State University explains carbon monoxide poisoning via vehicles, saying, quote, for carbon monoxide poisoning to occur, a person must breathe the CO. Holes allow the CO to enter the vehicle. When a vehicle is moving, holes or openings in the rear of the vehicle are under a suction which pulls in exhaust fumes. The suction effect applies when the rear tailgate window or the trunk is left open, or when persons ride in the back of a pickup truck under a topper. The suction produced as the truck is driven and the lack of ventilation in a topper combine to produce a potentially deadly combination, unquote. According to the National Fire Protection Association, the most common cause of death in fires is smoke inhalation. And while carbon monoxide is a component of smoke, Dr. Benz, who performed the autopsy, made a few interesting discoveries. There was, quote, an absence of carbonous material in the respiratory tract, and an absence of internal burning of the respiratory tract, but tests showed the presence of 80 to 86% carbon monoxide in the blood, unquote. With the strangeness of the pickup, investigators decided to exhume Clarence's body as well, and their discoveries only rose more questions. For starters, mortician Jack Bond couldn't find a gunshot wound. Even stranger is that the shotgun had been fired. Some theorized that the gun was fired and accidentally started the fire as opposed to killing Clarence. Well, okay, but what about Clarence's Masonic ring? The ring showed very little fire damage. John Kennedy, 30-year fire and explosion investigator, stated that the ring had a much lower temperature than the temperature needed to burn flesh. In other words, it would have been easier for the ring to burn than the body. Kennedy went on to conclude that the area where the body was found was drenched in flammable liquids, causing the acceleration of burning. More bizarre was that investigators now believed the limbs were removed prior to the fire. As for the body itself, he had only one kidney, which Geneva remarked that her husband had never undergone surgery. The dental x-rays also didn't match. The tooth found at the scene was of a lower right second molar. That particular molar had been removed from Clarence's mouth years prior to the fire. And the final nail in the coffin, as it were, was the blood samples. The body had type AB. Clarence, according to military records, had type B. Whoever the deceased was, it was not Clarence Roberts. The theory was that the man was a vagrant Clarence accompanied 2 days prior to the fire. Witnesses state the two were at a tavern in Morgantown, where Clarence bought him dinner and offered him work. The man, it's said, was approximately the same size as Roberts, but older. Walking out of the tavern, the man unexpectedly collapsed. Clarence placed him into his car and said he'd take him to a hospital. However, there were no records that the man ever made it to one. Further suspicion was made when police discovered that Clarence purchased a $1 million life insurance policy, naming his wife as beneficiary. Even with all the uncertainty and questions, some of the Roberts believed the man in the fire was Clarence, and that Geneva was entitled to the insurance money. But Geneva would never receive it. For over a decade, Geneva, her sons, and the pathologist appealed the insurance companies and court's decisions. Expenses getting the better of her, Geneva relocated to a smaller rental home and began working as a dishwasher. Police surveyed her home in the belief that Clarence faked his death and that she was in on it. Not only did authorities believe Clarence was guilty of insurance fraud, but there was also a warrant for his arrest in accordance to kidnapping and murder. In 1975, Brown County reviewed the evidence of the 1970 fire and found Clarence guilty of murder and kidnapping of the unidentified victim. Furthermore, witnesses came forward claiming that Clarence was alive and well, moving about different states. Donald Barrett testified during the insurance trial that Clarence was seen in Mentone, Indiana, in a tavern in April 1972 with a woman that was not Geneva. Between 1974 and 75, Clarence was reportedly seen in Mexico, New Mexico, and West Germany. Robert Jr. Hellenberg testified in 1979 that he saw Roberts in Las Palmas, Mexico in 1975. With these testimonies and expert statements eliminating the possibility that the deceased man was Clarence, the insurance companies declared in 1980 that Geneva didn't prove that Clarence was dead and refused her the money. 1 month later, another fire erupted. This time, the fire engulfed Geneva's rented home and took the life of two. The first body was positively ID'd as Geneva Roberts. Investigators noted that turpentine was poured around and on her body, trailing the rear door of her home. They believed this was an accelerant used to start the fire. Geneva's body was found on a cot, and her blood alcohol level was 0.3%. Legally speaking, you're considered drunk if your BAC, blood alcohol content, is 0.08%. According to In the Know Zone, persons with a BAC of 0.3 to 0.5 may suffer, quote, complete unconsciousness, depressed or absent reflexes, subnormal body temperature, incontinence, and impairment of circulation and respiration, unquote. What made the findings of Geneva's BAC more troubling was that she was diabetic and seldom, if at all, drank. But according to neighbors, her habits had changed. Geneva kept mostly to herself within her new life, but neighbors noticed that she purchased packs of beer often and that a strange man was lurking around her property since 1974. No one ever got a good look at him, nor did anyone know his name, but it appeared he may have lived in a home with Geneva. The grand jury ruled that she became unconscious as either the consequences of the alcohol, diabetic coma, or both. But what about the second body? The second body found on a floor in a storage room was identified as Clarence Roberts. His body in the storage room also contained turpentine. As it vaporized, the fumes were ignited by the wood stove. His BAC was 0.2%. Quote, because there is no evidence indicating any wounds, it appears that the male subject was either overcome by alcohol or overcome by fumes from the solvent which had been poured throughout the residence, a grand jury found. It is our conclusion that the female identified as Geneva Roberts was murdered. The cause of death of the male identified as Clarence Roberts appears to be accidental. While third-party participation is possible, existing evidence does not support that theory. Unquote. Both died of smoke inhalation. While the 1970 fire raised questions around the identity of the man found, the 1980 fire was almost certain by doctors and examiners that the second body found was Clarence Roberts. That was great for authorities. But the Roberts family refused to claim the body, and the Roberts sons dismissed signing a legal statement for mortician Jack Bond saying so. Quote, "I just wanted some kind of statement like that so they could not come back at me later and claim it was their dad and I didn't give them enough chance to claim his body. I wasn't really trying to push them either way. I can't fully understand it. They gave no reason at all. I know they have not felt this was Clarence, but after all these doctors said it was, and the experts took 4 days to go over it and make sure beyond a doubt, why won't they accept it?" Unquote. Geneva Roberts was cremated and buried in David's cemetery. John Doe is buried next to Geneva, while Clarence Roberts was cremated by the state. There are many theories and questions that linger around the Roberts. Who was the man killed in 1970? What about the woman Clarence was supposedly seen around with? Was Clarence the man lurking around Geneva's property? More importantly, was he actually the second body found in her home? The one thing that I feel can be stated is that Geneva loved her husband, and for the remainder of her life, she worked, cleaned, and tried to get what she felt she was entitled to. Her death was deliberate and heinous. Whether Clarence did it or a third party, the fact remains that Geneva was murdered, and her case has never really been solved. I'm Mrs. True Crime, and remember to be kind, be loud, be aware. For more information about Clarence or Geneva Roberts, why not check out some of these awesome links? And if you like what you saw and heard today, why not drop a like and a comment? Maybe subscribe while you're here? I make new videos every Wednesday, and you don't want to miss what's in store.